benefit both you and I. And it is our obligation to sustain the government and to sustain the government. We talking about government. And now let's talk about church. God has set up three governments in our dispensation and time. He set up the government of the family. He set up the government of the world. And he set up the government through the church. God has ordained ministers to service his people. And it is the people's obligation to make sure that the church is sustained, to make sure the organization, the government of the church is sustained, but not only to sustain the church, it is also to sustain the person who God has ordained. I didn't expect too many amens right there, but I didn't make this up. It's in your Bible. Paul says, read there, verse 7, tax to whom tax is due. He says, render custom to whom custom is due. He says, honor whom honor is due. He says, respect whom respect is due. I'm innocent of the blood of all men, because I did not hesitate to preach to you the entire counsel of God. Paul says, you owe the government taxes to sustain them. You owe the governor custom to sustain him, because he is benefiting you. Church needs to understand this. Oftentimes we don't think we need what God has ordained. And when we don't think we need something, guess what we stop doing? We stop supporting it. But God says, I didn't set this up for them. He says, I put this in motion for you. Let me help you. I got any Social Security beneficiaries in here? Guess where that comes from? I got any unemployed people in here who's receiving money from the... I got any people who got a card that they can go to the store and get some food in here? Guess where that comes from? All right. Paul says, God didn't institute this for them. God instituted this for you. And since God did it for you, it is your and my responsibility to sustain it. I'm talking about the government, but I got to talk about the church. Because we don't think that we have an obligation to sustain what God has ordained. And God, Paul tells us clearly in the text, we have an obligation to support what is benefiting us. Matthew chapter 22, verses 15 through 22. There, some religious leaders approach Jesus. They ask Jesus, trying to trip him up, is it right for us to pay tribute to Caesar? They expect Jesus to say, no, you ain't supposed to pay tribute to Caesar. You're supposed to do everything for God. But you know what Jesus says, don't you? He says, give me the money. Give me that denarius. And he looks at it. He says, whose inscription is this? And they say, that's Caesar's face on that coin. And Jesus tells the religious leaders, he says, give to Caesar what belongs to Caesar, but give to God what belongs to God. Let me be exegetically correct here. When Jesus tells them to give the copper to Caesar, and he tells them to give to God what belongs to God, he is not talking about money. Jesus had just given several parables about why a person should be obedient. When Jesus says, give to Caesar what's Caesar, and give to God what's God's, Jesus is saying, give Jesus that copper stuff, but God wants your obedience. When the last time you saw God's face on some paper? Never. God ain't interested in your money. God is interested in your obedience. And an obedient servant knows that it is right for me to sustain what God has ordained. I'm going to see you. But you and I should be submissive to the person God has placed over us, because God uses authorities to punish disobedience. God uses authorities to maintain order. And God uses authorities to fulfill his desires. You remember that preacher from Alabama speeding down the highway, bobbing and weaving through traffic, honking his horn, looking at people ugly, who pulled over to the side of the road and removed his sticker that proclaimed that I am a Christian. This story may or may not represent many Americans, many Christians in America, but what it does not represent is the biblical perspective of how both you and I should react to government. Jesus gives us the biblical perspective of how it is that both you and I should react to authority. When Jesus was in the Garden of Gethsemane and the government showed up to him and Peter pulled out his sword ready to fight the government, Jesus said, we don't fight government. We let the government do its thing, because Jesus understood that this government is about to fulfill the will of my Father. They think that they're about to kill me, but what they don't know is that no man takes my life. I lay my life down. Jesus said, go ahead and let this government do what this government wants to do. And the government thought they was doing something when they picked up those nails and put them in Christ's hand. They thought that they were doing something when they picked up those nails and they put them in Christ's feet. They thought that they were in control. And somebody wanted to know, if you're the Son of God, do something about this unjust government. But can you see Jesus hanging there saying, wait a minute. The government works for my Father. My Father does not work for the government. They killed my Lord. They killed your Savior. And when they thought they had done their just duty, God says, I have the last word. Government, you work for me. I don't work for you. God showed them this when he raised our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, on the third day. He showed us this when he set Christ on the right-hand side of him, where he remains even now. This is the message of the text. You don't have to oppose your government. They are working to fulfill the will of God. Get this, you can't see it, can you? You can't see how God would allow the government to kill his son, but God saw it. You can't see how God allows the injustice to happen in our world, but God has a plan, and he's using government to fulfill it. God expects us to submit ourselves to the people that he has placed in authority over us. May God bless you. May God keep you.